We're on.
Hello again. Sorry about the, we're having a technical glitch. We're channel 13. In any case, is there anyone from the public that would like to speak? And if so...
I still have to vote on, you just made a motion.
I'm sorry.
Do we need to repeat the motion in a second?
Yeah, why don't we just do that?
Move to seal the minutes from the 6:30 non-public this evening.
Second.
Okay.
Counselor Wright?
Aye.
Counselor Carmichael? Counselor Nazaro?
Aye.
Counselor Weinstein?
Aye.
Counselor Pike?
Aye.
Counselor Levy?
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0-1.
Is there anyone from the public that would like to speak? Mr. Allen?
Talk about taking the bull by the horns again, yeah. I'm getting tired of writing this writ back and forth to the...
Just state your address, just to...
56 Smith Garrison Road, Newmarket, New Hampshire.
Thank you.
Where you used to walk by.
I know.
We might be able to work this out without it ever even going to court, the rate that people keep cycling things and doing things, if I just state what I want, okay? One, the town, the district, 31, to turn it back to the town, municipality as a government, all the property, assets, accounts. Bring it back to where it was 25 years ago. Remove the superintendent. He's terminated himself, so that's taken care of. So that will be a moot argument. Buy the unions and schools and organize and any former labor unions from using social media, Facebook, Twitter, or any of the social media books. They've signed international clauses on their thing forever and a day. To formally, the school and the town, when writing a new ordinance for media and for elections, to put in a section defining by Supreme Court law flash mob, and definition of flash mob, and how it's handed without a permit, and when it, what the consequences of using it, if harm is to come to any particular person and violates their civil rights, whether it's a low-end civil rights or a high-end civil rights, doesn't matter. Civil rights violation, civil rights, a low one, high one, or all civil rights violation. Redefined it, added as an ordinance. The main crutch of this problem is bring the school back where the union can no longer cause the problems it did with the social media and the manipulation and the intimidation at public polls. I'm willing to go to the wall with them, and I can interlink them, and I can interlink the uses. I'm willing to drag them into international court, because when you sign Facebook, that's a heads up to the town. You agree to all their, 14 pages that you abide by international law. So they're hooked. No matter what, they're hooked. The use of the cell phones, all I can say is don't use a cell phone. There won't be a problem, because the Supreme Court's dealing with two cases right now that's been on TV, and they'll know within the next 120 days of how that's going to go with social media. Liability is too great with these flash mobs. What happened in Durham this week proves it, and what went on over there. They were moving crowds around. Why do two crowds of 500 kids come together for partying? What are they doing? The only way other governments have figured out how to do it is you put 16 droids up in the air. They cost about $1,700 a piece. You look down at them, and you would notice the kids are going in the woods, and they're coming together and passing with their hands. What are they passing? They're passing Molly. So it was a very successful show of what you can do with the police department, running them in circles when everybody's carrying a phone and moving about 30,000 Molly pills, which there's no test for presently, and other synthetic drugs, okay, for party purposes. What happens if that happens here with flash mobs? Who has the authority? You've given no authority. The school used through the union to push their thing by calling a flash mob. That flash mob sprung from this building and was on Facebook all the way to that school. Got in many languages. It made riot Thailand. And
can you please wrap up?
Huh?
Can you wrap up?
Yep. I think there's a lot of these problems that can be worked out without bringing it forward, but if it has to, let's not have this happen again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else from the public that would like to speak? Seeing none, please, we'll close public comment at 7:27. We also have a public hearing on the on an agenda item tonight, which is on the elections. It's ordinance 2013-14-02. Is there anyone in the public that would like to speak to the election ordinance? Mr. Allen.
Is that the new copy?
It is.
It wasn't posted. The newest copy was not posted about 4 days ago.
Well, we have the newest.
The copy that is the current copy was in the packets and posted at the beginning. So there's
okay,
no.
Okay, it's that one. So
yeah.
it didn't make it in what I was just talking about, flash mobs? When
no, not in the election ordinance, no.
Is there any way, would that change that ordinance we're going in drastically if something like that was added into it?
I think it would. But we, that could be something like the council and we could look at, because it's an ordinance. Once you have an ordinance, you can always amend it later. So
that's what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
That pushes us in the right way. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else regarding the elections? Seeing none, we'll close public comment at 7:28 on the elections ordinance. Next, can I have a motion, please, to accept the minutes of the April 16, 2014 meeting?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions? Please call the roll.
Councilor Wright.
Aye.
Councilor Carmichael.
Abstain.
Councilor Nazaro.
Abstain, not present.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Pike.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Yeah.
Motion passes 4-0-3.
Mr. Administrator.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Would you like to give your report?
On my report, written report this evening, first thing I provided with the town council, some information just on the town's overall tax rate in comparison to other communities. Of the 234 cities and towns in the state, just for your information, Troy has the highest tax rate of $32.26 per thousand. And Hart location has the lowest of $4.58 per thousand. Just to put the perspective on the population of Hart's location, it's probably about, I believe, less than 10. So there is some difference in the size as well. Newmarket's current tax rate is $24.46 per thousand. So we are number 78 on the list, going from highest to lowest in the state. The median tax rate is $22.42, and the average is $21.76. So actually, we're almost average our tax rate's almost average in the state. In comparison to some of our neighboring communities, Newmarket still does quite well. One of the things that we have, I don't want to say against us, but comparing tax rates, is the fact that we're so close to the seacoast, where the way we determine tax rates, and one of the big figures that we use is net valuation. So we're comparing ourselves to net valuation for the town is $744,537,983. So that's the value of the entire town. Rye, which is a little bit more than half our population, is $1.8 billion in valuation. So that's the difference that you really see. Newington, which has only 750 people, is just under $1 billion. They're mainly commercial and power plants. So the thing that we lose out on is there's still some government land in their community. So for around us, the highest tax rate is the city of Somersworth at $30.47. What I found interesting is the second highest is the town of Durham with $30.41. Again, the lowest is Newington with $8.99, then followed by Rye at $10.97, then Greenland at $15.50. Just wanted to provide this for information for the council. I also gave the council a list of the entire state on the report, and as soon as we get the new ones this next year, I'll provide it as well. The other items I wanted to provide updates with is that while it was one of the most controversial bills in the legislature this session, I want to share with you the impact of the passage of Senate Bill 367 FNA, which increased the road toll, or more commonly referred to as the gas tax. It went from 18 cents a gallon to 22 cents a gallon. This is the first increase the state of Hampshire has seen since 1991. Newmarket receives currently an estimated $137,226 annually from the state from this fund for improving, and it goes right to improving roads. With this increase, we're anticipating seeing an additional $19,500. So while it's not a lot, it's still going to be something that can help us. A lot of the money is being earmarked for the expansion of I-93, and I'm not sure exactly what happens when that project is done, how the numbers will change, and hopefully that will come back towards us. You know, this is one of the things, and when we work on the budget next year, I'm going to emphasize that the roads are one of our big future. If anyone asks me what our big future concern would be, that's my big concern right now is infrastructure. It would be the roads. We need to start addressing them more vigorously. Last Wednesday evening, we held a right to know law training for the various boards and committees in town. It was actually well attended. Myself, the town attorney John Radigan, and one of his partners Justin Passay, just went over a series of questions and answers and examples of items that come up with the right to know law, and we had a question and answer period during it, and it was recorded, and it's online. I believe it's being replayed as well. Actually, I'm planning on doing this for a couple of other topics, and I'd like to continue to do it annually. If some communities, what they have is like Citizens Academy for government, and the next one I'd probably do is sometime during the summer once the new charter takes effect, is sort of a Newmarket Government 101, is how we're set up. You know, what's the council, what's the town administrator, what's the planning board, what's the relationship between the town and the school, that kind of information, because Newmarket does have a unique form of government in the state. And the other one I would do is probably sometime before the budget season kicks off is Municipal Budgeting 101. Where does the money go, how much money goes where, you know, does the revenue from building permits go back to the building department, that kind of information, so people can get a little more information on how their government works. Not in my written report is that one of the things that new councils tend to do is begin addressing goals that the council wants to achieve, not only in the first year, but over a long period of time. And usually after the council sets goals, they review those goals and try to give the town administrator annual goals to help them achieve those goals within a year, and that's part of the performance evaluation. One of the things I was thinking and would ask the council to consider would be our new liability insurance provider has a free service of a facilitator to help the council write their goals down and codify them so you can have it all pulled together, and you'd have a goal setting session to get the bigger goals and what you want to have accomplished not only this year, but what do you want Newmarket to look like in 5 years, 10 years, so we can start planning, and that would also help us with the CIP and other items to, you know, try to get that information. So one of the things is I'd like to try to set that up in the near future. The other is
Who would be the facilitator?
It would be an individual from Primex, our liability insurance. I know the individual's actually named Carl Weber. He's done it many times in other communities. I've talked to the communities. They were very happy with him. He actually is a former town manager, so he knows this side. He's not somebody coming from, you know, just a consulting side. But I'll provide the council with all that information so you can work on it to set that if you want to do that. The second part is that I've provided council with some of the background for the goals that were set for me in the past so you can begin reviewing those to see what you may want to do for next year as well. You have non-public minutes been provided of what those were. And I think we're going to probably discuss that and review that non-public session in the next meeting.
When you say the next meeting, I don't think you're going to be at the next
meeting. I will be at the next one. I won't be at the June meeting.
Oh, okay.
So I'll be here.
So you will be at the next May meeting. Okay.
So, and that's all I have tonight, Mr. Chair.
Any questions, Dale?
The only comment...
Counselor Pike, excuse me.
That's fine. The only comment, I thought saying that our tax rate was almost average, we're almost $3 higher than the average tax rate. To me, $3 a thousand is a pretty substantial, so almost as a kind of a, you know, it's a judgment call, but I don't think it's that close myself.
Councilor Nazaro.
So I agree with what Councilor Pike said. I will not restate that. And I'm wondering if there's any mathematical, I know there's a mathematical way, I wonder if anyone's ever done this, to account for tax rate against valuation. You could use valuation to actually normalize it, so you actually could compare town to town if you normalize it using the valuation. It's probably a senior thesis someone might have done, UNH. But yeah, I'm just saying that right now we're comparing apples to oranges to kiwis to bananas, because all the valuations are different, so
you're
the rates
absolutely
are different.
And that's the big, that's been the fight for years, because that is how we determine it. You're right, because you've got
weeks we're doing the math necessary to make this happen.
But the way we tax is on property, is the value of the property.
Well, I know. I'm just, we could talk offline about it, but I think this is the way to do it. I don't want to take up any time to do it. For the just two more things. For the road toll, you have in here that we're going to receive an estimated $137,000 and change. Then you say, with this increase, we anticipated seeing an additional $19,500.
Yeah.
What is the variance? So 137
is what we currently get. We estimate we get.
Oh, we currently receive.
Right.
So we're just going to see an additional
about $20,000
right. from it. Okay. And my final thing is just on the part you added. Great to see that we're talking about goals. I know it's something that we've spoken about before. Then love the idea of a 5-10-year plan. Not so sure about a facilitator coming from an organization that would have potentially vested interest in making money off of us. So, not against the guy.
No,
don't know him for a whole
lot. And I'll best definitely give you all the information.
And I also think that we're just one elected body that I think has a role in that. I think we have a very important role, but the planning board's elected, the school board's elected, there's a lot of boards elected that probably should be part of that conversation. Thank you.
Seeing no other lights, I just have a couple of quick things. With respect to the list, I don't disagree, by the way, with regard to the to our tax rate. I think sent that to the council and several councilors and the administrator Fournier to sort of distribute for a couple of reasons. We're going to be having an economic development committee meeting coming up, and I thought it was important for people to, and we've said it, but I don't think you can sort of say it enough, that as we start to really look to see what we want to have the town look like, which I'm hoping is going to be part of our goals. It was interesting looking at some of those towns and some of the incredible growth and development that's taken place in some of them and what their tax rates were. That was the real purpose of why I forwarded that to Steve. And I sent it to a couple of counselors, I think, and then I just figured I'd give it to Steve, and I'm glad he forwarded it. And I'm not going to mention the towns in particular, but you can take a look at what some of the ones closest to us that people talk about a lot with some fairly aggressive growth. And their tax rates are actually north of ours or commensurate to ours, for whatever it's worth. So, you know, I can't say it enough that $45 million in new development, which is a lot of development, is a dollar on our tax rate. So I only say that because I think it's really important that we try to, you know, keep a handle on things as best as possible. The only other thing I'd like to mention briefly is, and I don't want to get into a whole right to know thing, the one thing I would say about the right to know meeting, because I did get a chance to watch it, I had a previous meeting that night and I couldn't make it, is I think there was a little bit of a misconception about, you know, someone puts in a request to see every email that Counselor A has sent to Counselor B, just for sake of making my point. And from my understanding, after having spoken to counsel, my own counsel, that would have to go to a quorum of counselors. So with all due respect to, you know, and I know there was a lot going on that night, and it did sort of get stated, I think, at one point by Attorney Radigan, but just so everybody knows, you know, we do have a little privacy in this world. I would urge councilors to not be sending emails to a quorum of the council. I frankly have not done much emailing. I don't like it in general, and that's why I forward almost everything to Steve to forward to the council. But just for the record, I think it would be nice to not perpetrate something that isn't necessarily true.
And that was, and, you know, that wasn't meant to be
said. I don't think it was intentional
at all.
It
wasn't intention. Yeah. What was meant to be said was a quorum of the council receives one document, that's a public document, and you shouldn't be doing that. So you can't do, but conversation between two councilors, that's fine. But if you do a chain, that's not okay.
Yeah.
So if you say from Council A to Council B to C to D, you can't do that. The other thing is, and I think people were kind of taken surprise that a communication between one counselor and myself or any department head or as agents of the towns becomes a public record. So that's why if you get something, it should come to me, so a quorum, so it becomes a public record immediately.
So everybody pretty much gets that. I just figured I'd say it just so it was heard, because there may have been a little bit of a misconception there. And that's pretty, as far as the goals, maybe we can discuss it at comment time, but I would have no problem starting our goal discussion just in general, either at the next meeting, and I'd like a little feedback from the council, excuse me, and we can do that, like I said, toward the end of the meeting at our comment time, or at the very least in June. I thought Steve originally told me it was going to be at the second May meeting. I'm glad you will be. So if it's going to be at the June meeting, we may want to start the discussion at the next meeting, just to start to circle around, and then maybe really nail it down the first meeting, if Steve isn't going to be at that, and then maybe close it at the end of June. And by the end of June, we'll have all our goals set, if that makes any sense to people. I have no problem with that. And that's it. Next on the agenda, committee reports. Does anyone have anything to report back to from any of the planning or the other committees? EDC is meeting, I believe, a week from next Thursday, is it?
Right.
And that will be posted online, and I would invite the public, if they have concerns, we'll have an agenda posted, and it's basically going to be what the committee wants to not vote on per se, but what we want to take a public position on agreement with Quasa study. Or not, and if we want to look at any type of changing of zoning or not, and we can have that discussion as a committee, and if anybody in the public would like to weigh in, that would be the time to do it. Okay? And that report is online, correct?
Yep.
Good. And no one else has any committee? Okay. And next on the agenda, under old business, do I have a motion to have ordinance 2013-14-02 of the elections approved?
So moved.
Do I have a second, please? Ellen, if you don't get who does it, because instead of me repeating it every time, you got it. Does anyone have any questions? And before we start the questions, we're going to have to make a.
I was just going to comment,
correct?
On that. Yep.
Do you want to?
Sure. One of the things that came up when I talked to a couple of councilors was there was concern about the wearing of paraphernalia or other campaign materials in the polling places. And so I reviewed the ordinance and came up with and talked to the attorneys and came up with a proposed amendment. If the council agrees to this, it would be to amend section 4.3, distributing campaign materials at polling place, and add a third paragraph, and it would read, No person should be allowed to remain in the building, observers, poll workers, etc. No person's allowed to remain in the building, poll workers, observers, etc., shall wear any clothing, shirt, hat, sticker, or button that indicates support or opposition to any candidate, question, or political party. That's where it was that we added that. However, this does not apply to a voter going to vote in his or her polling place. A person on his or her way to the vote may wear campaign paraphernalia or carry campaign literature if the voter leaves the zone promptly after voting. So basically is, if you're in the polling place and you're working or you're observing, you can't wear campaign materials or buttons or something like that, because it's campaigning in the polling place. If you're just going in to vote, and this is what the law is, you're allowed to wear it. Like, you can wear a button that says vote John Doe. You don't have to hide it when you're going to vote. You go in the polling place and you walk out. You can't hang around there. And the same with campaign materials. You can bring something in with you, but you can't leave it in there, and you can't pass it out to somebody else while you're in there. You say if you had something you wanted, oh, I like that person, I want to remind myself, you're allowed to do that. So that would be the amendment.
Questions? Councilor Weinstein.
I do have a question about that. And yeah. I agree with it. My only concern is if carry campaign literature could be interpreted too broadly. Can I walk in with a sign? Do you know?
Yeah.
So that would be my only, what your intent is.
But I think that's where the moderator's judgment as the election official for the day would have to come into play.
I would say it would, Councilor Nazaro.
So the RSA, I think 659, is pretty open to allow the moderator really to be the one that interprets it. My concern is that I hear what Councilor Weinstein is saying, that if we include that, then a citizen could walk in with the ordinance and be like, it doesn't say what the size it is, but it says I'm allowed to walk in here with literature. You know what I'm concerned that by putting the phrase literature in there, what we've done is sort of opened a doorway for people to come in to take it ad absurdum. I agree that people should be able to walk in and out, and right now it's the moderators. Like, if they're voting and they're wearing a pin, then, like, whatever, they're wearing a pin. And right now the moderator, it's at their discretion. They could tell them to take it off or not, the way our current ordinance is written. Totally get with the way what you're adding. Totally think it's right. I'm just concerned that, I mean, are we opening a door where the moderator's hands will be tied by the word campaign literature?
I can give just a quick opinion, and then you can address it. I think when I consider literature, it would be something like this.
I agree.
Yeah. I think someone walking in with a sign would be over the line, personally. And I think it would be easy enough to have literature and have the size of a standard sized piece of paper or a legal pad or something of that, a notebook. That is, I think, what the intent is, not to walk in with a billboard.
I agree. I agree if that's what the intent is. I'm just concerned that there could be an overzealous person out there that's going to use the language of the ordinance against it.
A couple things. One, when we wrote the ordinance, I did consult with the moderator and town clerk. Ultimately, this is just codifying state law. There's nothing in this that's not in state law because we can't do something that's outside of state law. And ultimately, also, it's the discretion of the moderator.
Yeah.
This is just something that somebody can go to as a simple document and say, look, our ordinances are, these are the rules. You know, you could legislate for any possibility. That's the only other thing I would say is, like, you know, you could say, well, if somebody tried to carry a sign in, well, what size sign? Is it a 6x8 or is it a regular 3x5? Is it a, you know, you can get to, I think in the judgment of any law, it's the judgment of the person who's going to be carrying it out. So I think you got to give that to the moderator as well.
I just want to make sure I'm sorry, may I speak?
Yeah, go ahead.
I just would want to make sure that in that paragraph, we're clear, or at least that it's incredibly clear that it's at the moderator's discretion to say whether or not something's acceptable.
It's in the ordinance itself that it's at the moderator's discretion.
Just everything needs to be at the moderator's discretion. All right.
Yeah, I have to be honest. I'm not too crazy about our carry campaign. I think the carrying campaign literature should have a parentheses around it and say, you know, notepad-sized paper or something of that nature because, you know, they're really...
I'll play devil's advocate.
Frankly.
What size notepad?
Yeah.
Legal.
You're going to get into that, and then they'll say,
"Oh, legal."
Yeah,
that's the biggest pad you can walk around with.
I would just say that I just wanted to make it so clear that it's the moderator's discretion, so that when the moderator says you got to take the sign out of here, someone's not holding the ordinance in their other hand and saying, "This says I can have campaign literature." That's all I care. Is that the moderator is not having their hands tied by the language.
Again, state law trumps any ordinances we have. Excellent. State law gives it to the moderator. It's his discretion.
I thought, though, we did have the reason we were doing this to some degree was because we had the latitude to be more specific for the town. Wasn't that the whole purpose
you,
of this?
You have more specific for the only thing you do is the corridor coming in?
Yeah.
That's it.
That's what we're talking about.
No, we're talking about having materials when you're voting inside. I'm talking, when we take quarter coming in.
So the quarter coming in doesn't include the polling place?
No. It's the door, it's from the door to the parking lot. And that's the law. This is really codifying, again, this is codifying what's already law.
All right. Well, I have a couple of questions, not having anything to do with how big a sign is.
Yep.
Number one, because I think we didn't do a very good job last time. And it wasn't necessarily anyone's fault, but it was, I think it was because people were overwhelmed. My one question was, who is going to enforce this? When you say the moderator, with all due respect, the moderator at the last meeting or vote that we had was collecting ballots that were a foot deep
mm-hmm.
from voters standing in line and then ultimately trying to put them through the machine, okay? So when you say all this latitude goes to the person who's the moderator, because I think we were so overwhelmed with the amendment, I think that was maybe, you know, the wild card at that particular vote. But the moderator was just overwhelmed. So I think when you know...
There are provisions in the ordinance that they may appoint monitors if necessary to oversee any outside activities. Also, state law allows the moderator to appoint deputies to help them if they need assistance.
Okay.
So they can appoint any number of deputies to process ballots, to do other jobs that they may have.
Okay,
so that's their right.
So I'm going to play devil's advocate. You know, we have another election,
mm-hmm.
and you know, they get slammed, and the moderator is running around just trying to, you know, because the reason he was collecting the ballots was not because he wasn't doing his job, it was because the line was getting so long that it was starting to go back to the front door.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if he hadn't done that, you know, it would have been out the door,
mm-hmm.
which we were between 5 and 7 or 8 or whatever
yep.
it was. So it seems to me that if that happens again, someone is going to have to, and I know that's their job, but in that particular case, they were so overwhelmed that they really didn't have time to start appointing lieutenants.
But there's no provision in state law allows anybody else to. It's only the moderator that can.
Okay, well, then the conundrum would be, and I don't want to beat it to death, the conundrum from my perspective would be, when this is happening and someone is being overwhelmed, and now you have somebody, let's just, to play the devil's advocate, walking around with, you know, campaign literature that shouldn't be in there for whatever reason, and they're not really being able to do anything about it because they're collecting ballots or they're running around trying to, you know, keep everything moving smoothly.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I made the question, who's going to enforce this? Because at that last election, there were a lot of things that didn't get enforced. And again, it's not an indictment. For example, since you're giving me a list,
I just don't want.
For example, there were cards left in voting
yep.
booths. Okay, that's a specific thing.
Yeah,
that said, vote for this person, vote for that person, vote for this one.
And again, state law does not allow any other individuals except the moderator and the town clerk to appoint other individuals at an election. We have no authority over that. The state law is clear. You know, only those two individuals can appoint additional people. People can bring it up to them, but it's their duty as individually elected officials to appoint others.
Councilor Pike.
Yeah, it may not be a matter of ordinance, but getting to the point of what happened at the last election, do you think there were sort of from the town officials that oversee elections, were there lessons learned?
Yeah,
about
absolutely. Absolutely. You know, talking to the old moderator, there's definitely lessons learned. You know, it's been tradition that elections are held in this building. That wasn't the right answer for this one. It's just, it's always been that way. It's, you know, tradition about how many ballot clicks you get, hours of operation, those kind of things. Those will have to be reviewed before the next big election. We do have a presidential one coming up in 2 years, so I think that's going to be lessons learned.
And I'm going to leave it at this. You know, I appreciate the fact that that's under the purview of the moderator. We also have an obligation to comply with state law.
Yes,
That's correct.
So when we're not complying with state law, we should really try to think about, you know, how to not have that happen again, and I'll leave it at that, because there were a lot of things that happened, and I'm going to reiterate, it wasn't, I think, in any way purposeful, but, you know, it just, there were a lot of things that were
And just for the record also, that there were Attorney General monitors at our polling place on Election Day, which is very rare for a local election. Usually comes out for state, but there were so many questions prior to this election and so many complaints to the AG's office, they called ahead and they came in. They reviewed the operations at the beginning. I don't know if they came again in the afternoon. They signed off. But yes, you're right. There's things that should have been done, and I know the election officials know that. So,
okay. Do we need to have a person make a motion for
to make an amendment three? To add paragraph 3 to section 4 to paragraph 3 of section 4.3.
Okay. Do I have a motion to add that? Let that language on number 3.
Is there a way you can just do a friendly amendment to
yeah,
it?
Yeah, that's fine.
That way we don't have to vote on the amendment and then vote on the I'd like to make a friendly amendment to my original motion to add paragraph 3 to 4.3, that third paragraph, as read.
And do I have second?
Second.
Okay. And the only other thing I wanted to just mention was, is there a, because I took the time to make the notes, I might as well ask them, is there a timeline for allowing a person who's wearing material promoting a position to be in the building and who is going to enforce the amendment? So I think that question's been answered. It'd be the moderator.
It's a moderator judgment.
Is there a timeline? In other words, let's say a person goes down and it's not, you know, crazy
yeah.
busy, and they're wandering around and just hanging out.
It's not like 10 minutes, no. It's the moderator's judgment. Because if you say somebody can't be in the polling place for 10 minutes, you're going to... Everybody comes out of the woodwork for elections. They could say, well, so-and-so's taken 20 minutes to vote. He's sitting at a table one where you can see his back that says, vote John Doe.
Okay.
So you got to leave it to the judgment of the moderator.
Okay. Any other questions?
Just one, what was your friendly amendment?
The friendly amendment was to add to paragraph 4.3, the third paragraph as you read.
Okay.
Meaning to add... Add three.
That's the part about
okay.
shirts.
Oh, okay. Yep.
So we have a motion and a second. We have no more questions. Do you want to call the roll?
Sure. Councilor Wright?
Aye.
Councilor Carmichael?
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro?
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein?
Aye.
Councilor Pike?
Aye.
Councilor Levy?
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0-1.
And that takes care of elections. Thanks be Lord. on page 30, we have... resolution 1314-56 regarding vehicle maintenance. Do I have a motion to accept?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Are there any questions regarding vehicle maintenance? Councilor Nazaro?
I just want to, not to keep hogging mic time, I just want to say that when Councilor Levin and I first joined the council, this was like novel, highly debated concept of outsourcing our vehicle maintenance, and I think that one, it's been amazing, and two, I'm glad to see that the lowest bidder is going to continue the relationship we've had, because they have 3 years of knowledge of our, almost 4 years now of knowledge of our vehicles that they're building on. So proud to support this.
And the only question I had was, because I couldn't, maybe I didn't have it or I didn't find it, are their rates commensurate to what they were last time?
Yes.
Okay, so everything stayed the same. They didn't, the markup, because I didn't see the original contract again.
I look at the public works director. Did it?
Did anything change at all? Did the markup stay the same?
I think the markup stayed the same. It was just the hourly rate.
What did their hourly rate change to?
$5.
So they went up
$5. 55 to 60.
Yeah.
55 to 60.
Where the rest of them were 85 and 69 for hourly. But we got proposals.
Okay. Real quick, Rick, and I know you're not going to have it, but I just give me a gut feeling. Do you think that's that $5 in general? Do you have any idea how much that'll move the needle up as far as overall cost of the town?
I'm not concerned.
I mean, obviously, you'd need to know what the hours are that they work.
But I'll be honest with you. They do a lot of things that they should charge us a lot more, and they don't, so.
Okay. Right, thank you.
Just quick back of the envelope math.
Yeah. Let Councilor Carmichael, because he's been.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, I apologize. Well, I had to write the names in.
Sure, you don't have a couple more questions?
Everybody changed seats, so I apologize.
To confuse you, just to confuse you.
This better be a good question.
Yeah, this is a real good one. I'd like to ask Rick to please come up here again and just tell us how you felt. I wasn't aboard when it was selected. I remember Councilman LaBranche and the whole thing. I thought it was a great idea that they did it. And at the time, you weren't really happy because you had your own mechanic that was retiring. And how do you feel, I guess my question, how do you feel about how it's working now? Are you comfortable with it?
We have a good working relationship with Auto Excellence. In the winter months when we have, you know, we're out at all hours, I can always get a hold of somebody and they come right in and take care of stuff. So if it's not something we can take care of ourselves and we need their assistance, they're always there for us. So it's, you know, back when you always had your own person, yeah, and you could, you know, tell them what they had to do and not do, you know, type of thing. So, but it's fine.
Okay. So you're comfortable with it?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah.
Councilor Nazar, do you have any questions for
us? No questions. Just assuming a normal work year, which is about 2,000 hours, then, and assuming we had a vehicle in there every minute of an average workday for a year, that's $10,000 a year, the $5 markup.
I just had no idea how many hours, because they might have two guys working on a vehicle. I just didn't know if he had any.
I mean, some days you'll go down there and his parking lot's full of town vehicles. It just happens. And then other times there might not be anything down there for a week.
You know? No, listen, I'm very happy with it. I think we've saved a lot of money, so I have no beef at all with it. I just was curious to know.
Yeah, I don't have those numbers, but it's not alarming or a concern, I guess what I'd say to you.
Mr. Administrator?
Yeah, I just want to add, too, that this is part of our new purchasing in system as well. I think in the past we may have been a little lax on when our contracts were up as well to go out to bid again. I think some department heads and some others are surprised that we've been saying, you know what, contracts up, go out to bid again. Well, we just signed it. Yeah, I know, but you have to do it every so often to make sure we're getting the best prices for the town. So I also want to commend the finance department as well for monitoring this and doing this more frequently.
And for whatever it's worth, the price and their markup of the parts is significantly lower than the other bidders. Yeah. Significant. So people can look at that for themselves. I'm not going to say what other people are charging, but it was pretty demonstrative. So anyway.
And I got to say, there's a lot of times where I personally think, you know, there's probably a couple hours and they charge us an hour. They call it an hour, you know, it might have been an hour and 20 minutes or something. But where they're coming in at 2 a.m. to work on a plow truck, and there's different rates for that type of call-in, and you don't, you know, they charge us like it was during the day. So, I mean.
Not related to this real quick, Rick. Have the parts, since Bud has been gone, been used up or sold back? Or
pretty much used up. There's a few items that are obsolete now because we've either don't have that vehicle anymore, and me and Frank just had a conversation about that. He's going to try to get us some type of credit.
Or get a restocking fee or something just to get rid of the stuff?
Some of the stuff we get a restocking fee, but some of the, this, pretty much everything's been pretty much used up.
Okay, thank you. We ready to vote?
Yep.
Let's do it.
Councilor Wright.
Aye.
Councilor Carmichael.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Pike.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Motion passed 6-0.
Next, on page 36, resolution 13-14-57, authenticating electorate's approval of 18 amendments to the Newmarket Town Charter.
So
someone like to make a motion? Thank you. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions? I think we've pretty much gone through this. Seeing none, please call the roll.
Councilor Wright.
Aye.
Councilor Carmichael.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Counselor Pike?
Aye.
Counselor Levy?
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
Now, if I did my math right, we jumped to page 71 now. Not that everybody doesn't know, but those amendments took up a lot of our space, our disk space.
That's laid on the table for the Harvest Way.
Yeah, so that's on the table. So now we have basically the first thing we have to deal with is the town council to appoint an alternate for the planning board.
The cable franchise? Ad hoc committee for the cable franchise?
Establish the cable franchise agreement.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's right.
That was the last one. So it was on page 71.
I was 72. Right. Oh, mine's different.
Okay. Anyway. 2013-14-58 for the cable franchise. It wasn't Harvest Way.
Mine's a different one, sorry.
Yes. Anyway, do I have a motion to accept the cable franchise agreement negotiating ad hoc committee? Do I have a second? When are we going to pick those?
As soon as you establish it, you can pick a member of the council, and we'll advertise for the member of the general public.
Okay, good.
And then the one representative from the school district. Okay. I believe they already have somebody in mind.
Okay, good. Please call the roll. Oh, I apologize. Yeah. Do you have a question?
That was just to mention that this was missed.
Counselor Wright.
Aye.
Counselor Carmichael.
Aye.
Counselor Nazaro.
Aye.
Counselor Weinstein.
Aye.
Counselor Pike.
Aye.
Counselor Levy.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
And now we need to appoint an alternative ex officio to the planning board. Do I have a motion for, yes, Counselor Carmichael?
No, I was just going to nominate somebody.
We were going to nominate you.
That's why I was going to nominate somebody.
Now, just to put this in perspective before we get, too wild with this is only in the event that Councilor Wright, who's missed virtually no meetings.
Well, it's not virtual.
And and promises to miss no more.
No promise.
That's only in the event that he can't make a meeting. So, does anyone want to make a motion? Would you like to do it? I thought you would make a great candidate for this, but
I'd love to accept that.
Well, someone has to make a motion for Councilor whomever.
I make a motion and nominate Ed Carmichael.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Do I have a third? Any questions? I think we should vote.
Counselor Wright.
While he's still here.
Aye.
Counselor Carmichael.
Aye.
Counselor Nazaro.
Aye.
Counselor Weinstein.
Aye.
Counselor Pike.
Aye.
Counselor Levy.
Aye.
Thank you.
Vote nay.
I won.
You can have balloons later.
You should have voted. Ed, you should have voted nay because you're so excited about
this.
Break
out the good stuff tonight, Ed.
Now I need a council member to make a motion. We have the planning board's made a motion for Val Shelton. Do we do these together, or should we vote on them separately?
Separately.
Okay. For the Economic Development Committee, the Planning Board has made a motion.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yeah.
So it's the Planning Board representative to the.
Yeah, they basically said they wanted Val to represent.
Why do we have to approve?
Their rules have it that they make recommendations to the council, and they ask.
The same with the Conservation Commission?
They're representatives, yeah.
That seems asinine, but okay.
It's the way life goes.
I nominate Val Shelton.
Councilor White, did you have a question?
I do have a question. I know that there is a...
I was going to say, can we have a second at first?
Okay.
And then
second.
We can... Okay, second about Councilor Carmen. Question.
And I don't know if this is the appropriate time to ask, because this has nothing to do with Valerie's appointment. But with the Economic Development Committee, I know that there is a person in the community who... There was a vacancy that was listed, that was posted on the town website, and there was a person in the community who was interested in that. And I was just curious... And she was told that I think that you were looking at the membership of the Economic Development Committee. So I was just taking this opportunity
to ask.
There was at one point at one of the discussions was whether what the size of the committee was going to be after this round. There was a discussion at one point whether.
When was that? I don't remember.
February. I think it was the one downstairs. But anyways, we still have we have the members.
There's 11 members now, just so you know, which is about as unwieldy as any committee I've ever.
Where you need to be.
Right.
I think we're beyond where we need to be, but we have about 11 members.
Some terms are up. Terms are held over until such time as others. So we'll just make sure we'll get them on the next agenda. I think it's the only members that are members at large, the public members.
Yeah, and
1 year terms.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, I remember I was appointed with you from the council, and I remember it was 11-member committee. Truthfully, I would have to go back, and maybe Steve can furnish us with that to address your question. I don't remember the term. I don't know if it was a year or two. I really couldn't tell you.
It depends on when there was one member for 1 year, and I believe there was two members at large.
So can we get can you just get us a total update on all the members and when their terms end?
Yep.
Is that possible?
That's possible.
The members should know too, because there may be some members that are at large.
They may not even know. Yeah.
Their term is up.
You know,
there is a member at large who knows his term is up.
You know, I think the assumption, in all fairness to when that was established. Because you weren't the chair then. I can't remember.
I was the chair here, not
were
down
you?
There. Yeah.
So that's right.
Yep.
And I think originally the concept was, and I don't know that we really knew, Tony. I think the thought was, it wasn't going to take a year. We didn't really, I don't think we really had a handle on it. I think the concept now is people would like to keep it going to sort of shepherd whatever the findings are and see if we can get something implemented out of a committee recommendation, which would be a novel idea in Newmarket. But in any case, because a lot of times people do a lot of work on things and then they never get really carried forward. But I really don't remember terms.
For the record, there's one for 1 year, one for 2 years, and one for 3 years when it was created last year. So you have a seat, because it's three seats for members at large. So if it's a three-year term, one person goes for 3 years, one goes for two, and one goes for one. So
we should
get it. Somebody.
We should really see when everybody's due and whatnot.
Yeah, I can tell the individual who's up is Jerry O'Connell. So we'll.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Just not to belabor this point, but I think that it was started one for 1 year, one for two, one for three, with the intention that they'd all become three-year terms.
Right. So but the next year.
It was just for the first.
Oh, yeah. No, that's what I meant. This year, this individual will be appointed for a three-year term.
There we go. It was just because
right.
of the founding, we wanted only one person up every
right.
year as opposed to all three of
that's,
them.
Yeah, that's what they do for all of them. So.
So can we just see where everybody is and who's got how much time left, just so we know?
Yep.
Sort of.
No, I. Yeah.
That said. Do I have a we need a motion. So I need a motion. We had a second to call the roll.
Councilor Wright.
Aye.
Councilor Carmichael.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Pike.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
And the same applies to the Conservation Commission. They suggested John
yep.
Brackett, correct? Okay. Do I have a motion to have John Brackett?
So moved.
By the way, the term, just while we're on, do
second.
I have a second? The term on both of these, do we know what the term is?
One year. Because anything coming from another board to another to
is
another board
year?
Is a one-year
okay.
term.
Well, does that mean we have to do, we have to vote? Well, actually, I was
it's
appointed.
You appointed.
Right.
So I would have to appoint, we don't have to do it now, but let me know when I have to
you
appoint.
You already did.
You did.
Do we already do all this?
When you did all the appointments.
When you did all the appointments, you appointed all
oh,
the members.
All right.
Yep.
Okay, I apologize. Good. All right. Call the roll, please.
Councilor Wright?
Aye.
Councilor Pickering? I'm sorry. Got my old sheet here. Carmichael?
Yeah.
Councilor Nazaro?
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein?
Aye.
Councilor Pike?
Aye.
Councilor Levy?
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
Okay. Now we get to read.
Oh, yeah.
No, I'm cool. First one is resolution 2000. These are first readings, but I do have a couple of questions, as I said, so bear with me on a couple of these. They won't be long. Let me read it first. Resolution 2013-14-59 relating to the town's investment policy.
This I would recommend that you read it by title only due to its length.
Hold on. Let me just. It's four pages.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I think I'm going to ask some. I don't mind reading it. I
that's fine.
I just think it might be good for people.
The council wants. Yeah.
I'll read quickly. Whereas pursuant to RSA 49:9-7, the town council shall annually review and adopt an investment policy for the investment of public funds in conformance with applicable statutes. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council adopts an investment policy as follows. Introduction. The intent of this investment policy is to define the parameters within which funds are to be managed. In methods, procedures, and practices, the policy formalizes a framework for the town's investment activities that must be exercised to ensure effective and judicious fiscal and investment management of the town's funds. The guidelines are intended to be broad enough to allow the treasurer to function properly within the parameters of responsibility and authority, yet specific enough to adequately safeguard the investment assets. Two, governing authority. The town council has the authority under RSA 41-9 town and RSA 48-16 to adopt this investment policy. Scope. The policy applies only to investments held by the treasurer, funds held by the trustee. The trust funds and the library trustees are excluded from the policy. Investment objectives. The primary investment objective in priority of order of investment activity shall be safety. Safety of principal, so this is obviously in the priority list, is the foremost objective of the investment program. Investments shall be undertaken in a manner that seeks to ensure the preservation of capital in the overall portfolio. The goal will be to mitigate credit risk and interest rate risk. B, liquidity. The investment portfolio shall remain sufficiently liquid to meet an operating requirement that may be reasonably anticipated. C, return. The investment portfolio shall be designed with the objective of attaining a market rate of return throughout budgetary and economic cycles, taking into account the investment risk constraints of safety and liquidity needs. And D, special considerations. Where possible, funds may be invested for the betterment of the local economy. For example, funds may be invested with institutions to reward them for promoting local economic development through its various programs and activities. Standard of care. Prudence. The standard of prudence to be used by the treasurer shall be a prudent person standard and shall be applied in the context of managing an overall portfolio. The treasurer acting in accordance with written procedures in this investment policy and exercising due diligence shall be relieved of personal liability for the individual securities credit risk or market price changes, provided deviations from expectations are reported in a timely fashion and appropriate action is taken to control adverse developments. The prudent person standard shall be defined as investments shall be made with judgment and care under circumstances then prevailing, which persons of prudence, discretion, intelligence exercise in the management of their own affairs, not for speculation but for investment, considering the probable of safety of their capital as well as the probable income to be derived. B, ethics and conflicts of interest. Officers, employees involved in the investment process shall refrain from personal activity that could conflict with the proper execution and management of the investment program or that could impair their ability to make impartial investment decisions. Employees and investment officials shall disclose any material interest in financial institutions with which they conduct business. Disclosure shall be made to the town council. They shall further disclose any personal financial investment positions and could be related to the performance of investment portfolio. Employees and officers shall refrain from undertaking any personal investments transactions with the same individual with whom business is conducted on behalf of the town. Six, delegation of authority and responsibility, maintenance of the cash book. The finance office shall maintain general ledger cash accounts by bank statement with enough transactional specificity that will comply with the requirements of maintaining a cash book. Bank reconciliation. The financial officer shall prepare for the treasurer's approval bank reconciliation. Such bank reconciliation shall reconcile bank balances to each general ledger cash balances and include supporting documentation for each reconciling item. Bank deposits. The tax collector's office with police escort may deposit town collections with a bank. Other internal controls. All departments must comply with the internal controls specified by the town administrator. We're almost done. The treasurer shall invest in the public deposit investment pool, money market accounts, certificates of deposits, repurchase agreements, and all other types of interest-bearing accounts of federally insured banks, chartered under the laws of New Hampshire, the federal government with a branch in the state. The treasurer shall amounts of investments in a manner. It doesn't read right. That will mitigate the concentration of credit risk. Concentration of credit risk is a risk of loss attributed to investment in a single insurer. Collateralization. The treasurer shall collateralize deposits in an effort to mitigate custodial credit risk. Mitigation includes segregating deposits to be covered by federally deposit insurance or similar insurance. Foreign investments shall not be allowed. So, and that's the first read. And I had a couple of questions because I don't want to get to the next meeting and then not be able to have the answers. Does anybody have any questions before I ask a couple? Let me just get to one because this thing was like 3 miles long.
Just real quick, rather than like sort of going against our council rules and asking questions the first time, can we just consolidate them, get them to you, or they even have him have the answers before the next meeting?
That's probably the best way. If you want to email me the questions, we can make sure we're prepared to ask them.
Yeah, and the only, you know, we have at times, the only reason I brought this up to Steve before the meeting, and I only have a couple, but I think they're relevant enough that it won't take long. I'm not looking for the answer now.
Yeah.
But we have, when we have these types of things, the problem is, when we get the next packet, all my notes are in here, and then I have to go back and then reread all of that. So just very briefly, on page 75, at least my page 75, when it's talked about investment policy, there may be a need to have multiple accounts FDIC insured, as the limit is only $250,000. Mm-hmm. So I just thought I'd bring this up because that can get a little tricky. Also, who is overseeing the treasurer? You don't have to answer any of this now. I just
depends on June 30th and July 1st.
Okay, well, but the point is,
yeah,
that's a question. It's going to be somebody's position.
On right? July 1st, it becomes an appointed okay. position.
And then the only other thing I had is that concerned me, frankly. It said investment policy. I would like some clarification. It's on page 75, on number D. It said investment, investment policy that states, where possible, funds may be invested with institutions to reward them for promoting local economic development through various programs and activities. And my feeling on this was the town should not be taking risk with its money for developer or private development, in my opinion. So I'd like to have a okay. better understanding.
But I want to clarify, I'll get you the full answer with the good. Finance director. That's good. Not what it means, because I don't want people to think out okay. there think good. They were giving money to developers.
Okay.
So not happening.
Well, if you read that,
I understand. It's to invest with banks that provide basically low interest loans to companies that may want to develop in the community, those kind of things. That's what some communities do have
so
in
the
there.
Word yeah. institution. Is
right.
Bank.
The bank is yeah. the institution.
It's okay. I have my own concerns yep. about it, so I'd like fine. Some clarification. Okay. And that's it for me. Next resolution. Page 78, resolution 2013-14. Application of $1,055,000 to install a 16-inch water main to include improvements to utilities and tank vault and authorizing the administrator to sign said loans. Now that's two pages. Would you like me to read that?
It's okay. It's up to you.
Well, I think we should, you know, I think the public, a lot of them don't have this, so I don't mind. It's two pages, I don't mind. Whereas Section 5.11 of the Newmarket Town Charter enables the town council to authorize all borrowing of funds and further stipulates that for the purposes of borrowing, the town of Newmarket shall have all the powers and duties vested with the city, and whereas the town of Newmarket, after thorough consideration, hereby determined that replacing an 1894 8-inch water main with a new 16-inch water main is desirable and in the public interest, and to that end it is necessary to apply for assistance from the State Revolving Fund SRF, and whereas in addition to the SRF loan, the town of Newmarket desires to apply for any and all state and federal loans and grants that may assist in funding this project, and whereas the town of Newmarket has examined and duly considered the provisions of RSA 486 semicolon 14 in the New Hampshire Code of Administrative Rules, Chapter ENVDW 1100, which relates to the loans, to loans from drinking water state revolving fund, and deems it to be in the public interest to file a loan application and authorize other actions in connection therewith. Okay, hold on a sec. My computer just freaked out a little.
Can we read that? I got it.
Yeah.
Are you finished?
Yeah, go ahead.
Now, therefore, let it be resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does approve this resolution as follows. One, that the town administrator is hereby authorized on behalf of the town of Newmarket to file an application for loan to be made in accordance with the New Hampshire Code of Administrative Rules, Chapter ENV-DW 1100, and that the two, the town administrator is hereby authorized on behalf of the town of Newmarket to file any other grant or loan applications that may assist in the funding of this project, and three, that if such loan may be made, the town of Newmarket agrees to repay the loan as stipulated in the loan agreement, and four, that the town administrator is hereby authorized to furnish such information and take such other action as may be necessary to enable the town of Newmarket to qualify for the loan, and five, that the town administrator is hereby designated as the authorized representative of the town of Newmarket for the purpose of furnishing such information, data, and documents pertaining to the application and loans for a loan, and as may be required, and otherwise to act as the authorized representative of the town of Newmarket in connection with this application. And six, the certified copies of the resolution shall be included as part of the application to be submitted for a loan. And seven, that if the, such loan be made, the town of Newmarket agrees to make provisions for assuming proper and efficient operation and maintenance of the facilities after completion of the construction thereof. First reading, May 7th, 2014.
Thank you. Councilor Pike is going to read the next couple.
Resolution 2013-14-61 relating to updating the elevator town hall protective device. Whereas the elevator doors at the Newmarket Town Hall utilize a mechanical door reopening system that requires contact with a person to reopen the doors, and whereas an infrared door protection system can be retrofitted in the elevator, which will provide physical contact to initiate a door reopening, and whereas our elevator service provider, Stanley Elevator, quoted $3,900 to retrofit the elevator with infrared door protection system, and whereas town meeting created the Town Building Improvements Fund on May 14, 1996 for the purpose of improving town buildings, and whereas the Town Building Improvements Fund has a balance of $317,699 as of March 13, 2014. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does hereby approve a transfer from the Town Building Improvements Fund not to exceed $3,900 for the purpose of updating the elevator with an infrared door protection system. First reading, May 7, 2014. Resolution 2013-14-62 authorizing the town administrator to enter into an agreement for granite curbstone for Packers Falls Elm Street. Whereas the town of Newmarket solicited for written quotes for granite curbstone for Packers Falls Elm Street, and whereas two qualified New Hampshire suppliers submitted proposals, and whereas after evaluating the proposals, the public works director recommends the proposal submitted by Tri-State Curb for 1,325 linear feet at $16.80 per linear foot for a grand total of $22,260. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does approve the town administrator to enter into an agreement with Tri-State Curb for granite curbstone not to exceed $22,260. First reading, May 7th, 2014.
Thank you. Could I get the dimensions, or could the council get the dimensions of the curbstone? Thank you. Next resolution, page 82.
Can I read it?
Yeah, I don't mind. Resolution 2013-14-63, authorizing the town administrator to enter into an agreement for energy savings lighting retrofit for town hall. Whereas Public Service of New Hampshire, PSNH, funded a lighting energy efficiency audit of the town hall and school administrative offices for the town of Newmarket, and whereas PSNH offers a 50% cost match of $7,894.79 of the total project cost of $15,788.80. You've got to pay him that 80 cents.
Yeah.
And whereas this audit identified numerous efficiency opportunities that would yield a 4.1-year payback on the town of Newmarket investment. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does approve the town administrator to enter into an agreement with the Lighting Retrofit Services, Inc., not to exceed $3.83. And my only thing there was, could we get, who did the cost-benefit evaluation? Could we just get that?
They will be here at the next meeting.
Oh, good. And we're getting close, folks. Page 83. Just looking to see how long it is. It's two pages. 2013-14-64, an engineering contract for the New Hampshire, Route 108 bike path construction shoulder widening. Whereas the town of Newmarket has been awarded a grant from New Hampshire Department of Transportation, DOT, NHDOT, under the Congestion Mitigation and Air Quality Improvement Program with a total cost of $809,292, with 80% of the cost coming from the Federal Highway Administration, FHWA, $647,433.60, and the remaining 20% of the cost, $161,858.40, coming from the toll credit funds from the state of New Hampshire. And whereas the Newmarket annual town meeting voted to raise and appropriate the sum of $809,292 for this project on April 6th of 2010, and whereas the town of Newmarket wishes to enter into an engineering agreement with Underwood Engineering, Inc. for engineering consulting services related to this municipality-managed project involving shoulder widening and the construction of a construction of 1.8 miles of bike lanes along New Hampshire Route 108 from Newfields Town Line to Bennett Way for safe bicycle travel, and whereas Underwood Engineers was selected for these services through a qualifications-based process in accordance with federal, state, and local procurement requirements, and whereas Underwood Engineers has provided a proposal for professional engineering services and the town has negotiated a contract price for this work, and whereas the town has performed an independent government estimate, IGE, which was used as the basis for contract negotiations as required by federal guidelines, and whereas the New Hampshire DOT has reviewed the town's procurement qualifications process, the independent government estimate, and the consultant's engineering scope of work and cost proposal, and has authorized the town to enter into this agreement, now therefore be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does hereby approve the signing of a contract with Underwood Engineers in the amount of $37,600, and the funding to be from Congestion Mitigation and Air Quality Grant, $30,080, and the New Hampshire Department of Transportation toll credit, $7,520, totaling $37,600. The town administrator is authorized to sign this agreement May 7th of 2017. And could we just get how many engineering firms did on
that? All that in the backup.
And?
Let me grab them?
Dale's got the last three.
I'll take them.
If you don't mind.
Resolution 2013-14-65, a resolution relating to the purchase of two LifePak 15 monitor defibrillators for the fire department. Whereas the fire department maintains two LifePak 12 monitor defibrillators that are 10 and 11 years old, and whereas the LifePak 12s are beyond the manufacturer's suggested life expectancy, and whereas the manufacturer will end their support of the LifePak 12s next year, and whereas Physio-Control is the sole source provider of LifePak monitors and defibrillators, and whereas Physio-Control's cost proposal for two LifePak 15 monitor defibrillators, is it fibrillators?
Fibrillators.
Yeah, it's not okay. And anyways, is $60,831.40, which includes a trade-in value for the LifePak 12 monitor defibrillators. And whereas the ambulance revolving fund has a balance of $204,824 as of April 30, 2014. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does hereby authorize the town administrator to enter into an agreement with Physio Control to purchase two LifePak 15s at a price not to exceed $60,813.40, and further approve the withdrawal of funds from the ambulance revolving fund. First reading, May 7, 2014.
Just one thing, Steve. Can you find out if there are other companies that make something called?
It'll be in your next packet, the reason why.
Okay.
Resolution 2013-14-66, withdrawal of $165,000 from the Municipal Transportation Fund for the purpose of road maintenance. Whereas the town of Newmarket allocated $125,000 for paving in fiscal year 2014, and whereas the Municipal Transportation Fund, RSA 261:1536A, was established to fund improvements in the local or regional transportation system, including roads, bridges, bicycle and pedestrian facilities, parking and intermodal facilities, and public transportation. Funds may be used for engineering, right-of-way acquisition, and construction costs of transportation facilities, and for operating and capital costs of public transportation only. Funds may be used as a matching funds for state and federal funds allocated for local or regional transportation improvements, and whereas the Municipal Transportation Fund currently has a balance of $238,859 as of March 31, 2014, and whereas the funds will be used to apply the finish wear course on Ash Swamp Road from Route 152 to Grant Road, reclaim and overlay 1 mile of Ash Swamp Road, Route 108, and as follows. Source of funds, general fund appropriation of $125,000, Municipal Transportation Fund for $165,000, and it's therefore a total of $290,000. Use of funds, finish wear course, $135,000, reclaim and overlay, $155,000, total $290,000. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does approve the withdrawal not to exceed $165,000 from the Municipal Transportation Fund for the purpose of paving projects to Ash Swamp Road. First reading, May 7, 2014. And last but not least,
Recreation, Fitness, and Wellness.
Resolution 2013-14-67, relating to the purchase of laminate floor for recreation, fitness, and wellness programs utilizing recreation impact funds. Whereas the Newmarket Recreation Department has experienced a new demand for increased program activity relating to fitness and wellness programs. And whereas the current facility does not contain a floor for this purpose, and whereas the cost proposal for this need is $2,828.88, and whereas the Recreation Impact Fee Fund has a balance of $39,285.21. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does hereby approve the expenditure of impact fees not to exceed $2,828.88 for the procurement of a laminate floor for the Recreation Department. First reading, May 7, 2014.
Thank you very much. Any correspondence to council or administrator? Closing comments by any councilors? Councilor Nazaro?
Yeah, just real quick, and with all due respect, because I totally get it, I agree with it to the content of every question that you asked. We have council rules saying that during the first reading, we don't ask questions, and I totally get it. I had questions, some questions too. I think that we might want to edit the council rules, because if we all got to ask questions, it would take forever. Maybe we all, before the meeting, get the chair questions, and then the chair says, these are the questions the councilors have on each of the ordinances or resolutions, so that when you're adding that, then all of us can do that.
I'll make a suggestion.
What the purpose of the first reading is, so everybody, including the public, receives it. During that time, each councilor does their own investigations. I, as the town administrator, can go to my staff and say, look, I'm getting these questions. Be prepared to answer them at the next meeting. So you can ask me the questions. You don't even have to go to the chair on that one. So send me an email, say, look, Steve, I was reading over the packet. I got a question on this one. Can you make sure it's addressed in the next meeting? And we'll do it that way. It's fair for us, too, because, I'm sitting here, and this happens to everybody. We're asked questions, and the staff's not prepared, and it looks like I'm not prepared. I know what you're saying. It's for the next meeting, but
I'm more concerned about, because I remember Council Levy and I were on the council and we changed that rule, because the first reading turned into a long debate,
right,
and the second reading turned into a long conversation, and it just was two conversations about the same ordinance. I would just ask that we either found a way that all of us could get the questions and the chair asked them, or just for equity purposes.
Or you can just ask me. That's your right as individual counselors, is to, once you have it, is to come in and ask me those questions, and we can disseminate the answers.
I'll tell you the reason it's been hard for me and frustrating. And we have made more than a few times, if there's been something quick, and I don't think I spent more than I understand, but I don't think I took more than a minute and a half to get the questions. What happens is, when I read these, and I'm making annotations, and then we get the next packet, and they give us some of the backup information, then I have to jump back to all the questions and or read all the stuff that I've already read. So it's easier to have...
If the council wants me to have backup for all meetings, we mean you can have it for both.
No, I'm not saying, listen, I think if there's something really, for example, I didn't even bring up on the bike path, how long is it going to take us to get the money? That's a two-second question that Steve could say, oh, when are we going to get reimbursed from the feds, okay, or whomever it is going to fund us. My feeling is if there's a few questions that come up from a first read, because they don't give us all the backup. They used to give us all the backup.
Right.
And then it was incredibly painful because you'd make all these notes, at least I would do that, and then we'd get our next packet, and I'd be like trying to reconcile them both, and I don't feel like, frankly, doing the work twice if I don't have to because I spent enough time. So I don't think we have to get all the information in each meeting. I frankly don't mind the idea of if we have, because honestly, to ask a question, not expecting any answers, which I made very clear to Steve that I was not looking for any answers tonight, I would be more in favor of, if you want to forward me the questions, I'm fine with it. I don't mind going around one round saying, geez, I had two questions on this, Steve could get us questions.
I'm fine with that either. To me, it's just, I totally get what you're saying, Chairman. That it's just that none of us have that luxury right now to ask those questions.
Well, you can hit the button.
Well, just the council rules, though, say we're not supposed to. That's my issue. But so if we want to change it, I'm fine with it.
Well, Council Wright.
All right, great ideas. But at what point do we submit the questions? The first reading, the second reading? Because I'm afraid if we do it the first reading, we're not going to have some of the information that's there. And whether it's Sean or Rick or... Go ahead.
If I may. I agree. You're right. What we do, and again, this is why you have two readings. The first reading is just to let everybody, including the public, know it's out there. It's not the time to ask questions. It's time for you to gather information. My recommendation would be send me the email so I can give it to my staff to say, look, I've got these questions. And I prefer it in writing. The reason why, I can get your exact question. Because if I get it on the phone or I get something like that, I can say, well, that's not what I meant. Well, it's easier to say, look, can you make sure you have this when we're there? And then we have a record of it, too. So this is a good time. And you may not have a question. Maybe a simple little resolution. You don't even need to go around and say, do I have a question on it? So this is what happens in every other council forum, is the first reading is just to let it out, and you ask the questions in between and do your research. You can meet with me. We can bring people in, whatever. That's what you do. The second one is when we have it in public and the debate between councils happens. The second reading shouldn't be questioning the town administrator. It should be getting the information, the backup from the staff member, and then the council debating the merits of the resolution or ordinance. So I think that's probably the best way to do it, is send me the questions. We'll be prepared and ready for that meeting, and we'll have it for you. And
I'm just looking for an equitable vehicle of questions.
I'll leave it at this, because I don't have a problem going along with that. I spend X amount of hours dealing with the town stuff. I read a resolution or an ordinance that we're proposing, and I have a question. To be honest with you, it's a heck of a lot easier for me to say, when are we being reimbursed by the feds for the road, than it is for me to have to annotate it here, then write an email to Steve, which takes 15 minutes by the time I do the whole thing. And it's just, to me, a lot quicker to just ask the question. But that's just my take on it.
I agree with this. I'm just saying, what about the rest of us?
Well, no, I have never, frankly, I've never said anybody that hit a button not to ask a question. And right. And I think there have been more than a couple of occasions since we, made those rules.
Yeah.
Where a counselor said, oh, by the way, could you get me this? And Steve has gotten it. I think Larry at a couple of occasions asked. And I don't think it's really that big a deal. But I appreciate the fact that we should have a format. And I'll leave it at this. If I had my preference, I would rather ask Steve two or three or four questions like I had, because we had a hell of a lot of resolutions tonight. We had like seven or eight new ones. I would rather, if it's a one or two, like the investment thing, I'd rather say, Steve, could you just tell me if it's going to be FDIC insured, if they're going to open up four accounts, than have to sit there and aggregate all my questions, and then, because we're doing the read now, So the read makes sense to ask the question to it versus me having to sit there and then get my other computer and start writing out an email, and that's why it's very burdensome. That's why I bring it up, because I would rather, if there are quick questions, I don't want answers from Steve. I wasn't looking for any answers at all. And like I said, there's more than a precedent for us doing this at past meetings within the last year. So
as long as we all can ask questions at that point, then...
Well, I have no beef with that, and I never have.
Okay. So. It's just that I think our council...
I mean, does the council... I mean, just give me some feedback from other people. Does anybody really have a problem if there's a couple of questions that come up from a first read? Is it that big a deal?
No, absolutely
not. Because I'd much rather... Because I take the time to do all this and to then have to, you know, go to my email, you know, my other computer, because I don't email on this, and then start writing a bunch of emails is, to me, very burdensome and, frankly, redundant.
Is it easy to change our rules so that there it recognizes what
yeah.
in fact
and,
is
and
practice?
Yeah.
And my other thing is I would put in there, do not expect...
Yeah, I just... I
know you are saying that, but I need to make sure in the future, don't expect answers.
We're not...
And I know that, and I understand that, but I'm saying this turns into...
Yeah.
To me, it's going to turn back into what you had before. That's what you don't want to have happen.
So that's fair. So if somebody has a question, and please use your judgment, and I'll tell you what. If it starts getting, you know, very timely, we can adjust. But frankly, I think it would be a lot better for Steve, staff, and us, who have a lot of balls in the air right now. At least I've got an awful lot, not that everybody doesn't, but I've got a lot of things going on. And to have to just re-email all this, to me, is...
Yeah.
More than I think is really necessary. So, are there any other comments from councilors? Councilor Weinstein?
I just wanted to talk for a second about the collaboration between the town council and the school board. I know that we've been asked by the community to work together. And I know that at a recent meeting about a month ago that that Chairman Levy spoke about the role of the town council and how the town council might be able to play a role in the school facility question. Again, at the most recent school board meeting, the school board chair talked about meetings that the chairs have had and how the respective boards might be able to work together. And I'm excited about the fact that you guys have been meeting. And I would just, I'm curious how...
Would you like an update?
I would like an update, and how the boards can continue to work together, and how we might be able to be more involved in the process.
I've had two meetings with Gail, and talked to her a few times on the phone, and we're trying to figure out how to put together the proper format to get a process in place that will work. And I would prefer, excuse me, having Chairman DeRozier lay it out, because it's really under the purview of the school board. And I respect, as I said before, the process. I think she's working very hard to reach out to the Department of Education and some folks that may be able to furnish the town with some people who can help us facilitate this and do it in a manner that will give us the resources so we can do the job thoroughly, professionally, and frankly, with credibility for the whole community. And I think that's been the emphasis, at least from my perspective, that the whole community can sort of buy into whatever the process ultimately is. Because up to this point, prior to, you know, the town council ever having any involvement whatsoever with the school board, other than having a personal opinion whether, you know, we like this or we don't like this, or we want a school or we don't want a school or whatever, it's been really no relationship. I mean, we had one meeting downstairs about trying to find some economy of scale when the efficiency committee was in play, which I don't believe there is there even an efficiency committee anymore.
Don't.
Well, when it was, I think they were talking about trying to find some economy of scale with respect to whether it was the IT or whether it was, you know, facilities or any type of sharing and this and that, and I don't think anything ever really came from it. So looking at the past history, at least from speaking for myself, I think Gail's approach is to try to make sure that, okay, there are people that feel this way, there are people that feel that way. We would like to try to come up with a process where, whether everybody agrees, because I don't think everybody will ever agree on anything, you know, in this town, to be honest with you, but we want to try to have a format whereby there's credibility and believability with a solid majority, let's say it that way, or at least that's my interpretation. So that's where we are. And I think some of these things, as much as I'd like to see the facilitator or the consultant or whomever or whatever you want to call that individual just happen overnight, it's not that easy to just have that happen. So that's why it's taken, you know, I mean, I met with Gail, I think, the first time about 6 to 8 weeks ago. I left out Wentworth in the last name, so I apologize to Gail for that. But in any case, that's sort of where we are. And I'm hoping that within the next 45 days or so, there'll be something that comes of it. But I really don't feel like it's my place to preempt anything, because at the end of the day, you know, the school board may decide, you know, we want to do this, we want to do that, we don't want to have anything to do with the council, this is our thing. So I sort of feel like it's not my place. I think it's really Gail's place and the school board's place to make the determination as to how they want to proceed. I hope that wasn't too serpentine route, but I think I touched most of the bases. I think you get my point. You didn't understand that, Ed? In any case, that's my answer, and I stick by it. Two things I just wanted to make a quick statement on, or not quick, really. Martha McNeil, I understand, is in the hospital, and I'd like to, you know, just let everybody know that, and hopefully everybody will say a prayer for her. I think she's stable, at least I hope she is. I haven't really been able to get a lot of feedback. I have great respect and admiration for Martha, and I think she may be in ICU or something at this point, so.
Yeah, my understanding is she's in ICU. She's going to be for a little bit, and then she's got some rehab to do, but she's doing well.
Good. So I'm happy to hear that, so I just thought I'd say that. And also, something, speaking of the school, came up at the last meeting, and I don't know if it's too late, but having gone to the DPW building a couple of years ago when we were reviewing some of the trucks, there was a fair amount of space that was unoccupied when I was there. Mm-hmm. This was a while ago. So, and I mean a fair amount of space. It was several thousand square feet by my calculation. So I heard the statement, I think at the last school board meeting, that they had, or they were ordering some storage trailers to store, I apologize for not knowing all the facts on this, but I think it had something to do with either the renovation or the rebuilding or replacement of the building that has to, you know, has to go, mm-hmm. because it's not meeting safety standards and whatnot. So I didn't know if they haven't already ordered those. I didn't know if you might, meaning the administrator, want to reach out, because if we have some town storage that, you know, would be insured by them and us, if they, rather than having a bunch of trailers roll up and store stuff that might cost the town money, yep. and not needed, it would be a nice thing if we did have the rooms. Rick, yep. had the room. Just a thought, because I don't know how many trailers they were going to order, but it sounded to me like they were quite a few.
Yeah, I'll see if.
And, you know, a trailer doesn't hold nearly as much necessarily as the space I saw there, but
yeah, I'll see what they need, what we need. Yeah.
Just thought I'd bring it up,
yep.
and maybe you can let us know if that's even feasible.
Sure.
And that's all I had. Anyone else? Do I have a motion to adjourn? Do I have a second?
Second.
We are adjourned.
I have one document I need everybody to sign.